All right, dude, we are live. What's up, guys? This is Damn Keys, and holy shit, dude, it's been I think a week and a half since I did a vocal stream, a stream where I talked. And I mean, it's also been close to a week and a half since I streamed. I streamed yesterday, but I did a mute stream. It was one of those things where, like, it just, the time just got away from me and I wasn't able to. Dude, I need to get better at just streaming more. I keep saying this, but I don't do it. I need to get better at just streaming more, even if it's just mute streams. Okay, either way. So what we are doing today is, so recently I got back into doing my electronics stuff, more specifically playing around with the microcontrollers and the various like modules that you can attach to them. And in order to make the peripherals, the modules communicate with the microcontroller, you have to use some form of serial communication. And there's a couple of different protocols that exist for that. So I've been reading up on that, and I've also been slowly exploring the ESP32 much more to get an idea of what all I'm able to do with it. Something else that I've been doing is, so what I want to do is I want to go through the Arduino examples. Let me see if I can bring that up here so I can show you guys. Give me a second. Oh shit, I was supposed to transition so it doesn't say mute. The mute text was up on the screen. But okay, I'm gonna transition to the BRB screen, and just real quick, Arduino examples. So this is something I really liked about Arduino. It's that Arduino is great for beginners. I mean, it's great for even like more advanced users, but like if you are an absolute beginner, it's great. Let me show you why. One example of why it's great for beginners. Let me just transition back. Okay, so hold on. I have Fillion's stream running on a different system, just so I have like some extra stimulation for my brain. And she tends to just randomly scream. I don't know if her scream just came through on. Give me a second. Actually, BRB. Treat me so well.
spell.
All right, I'm back. So just like yesterday, I started the stream and instantly, well, not instantly, but a couple of minutes later, I had to go into BRB. But yeah, okay, so I don't remember what exactly I was talking about. However, it was something, I know that it was something relating to serial communication. And so I've been learning about serial communication and the various protocols that are available. Yesterday I was reading up on SPI, Serial Peripheral Interface, and today I've been reading up on I2C. I'm not done reading up on it. That's actually the plan for today's stream. Once I've gotten more comfortable with using I2C, because I noticed that a bunch of the modules that I do have, they use I2C. I need to look for the ones that might be using. Actually, I have some of them here. Give me a second. Let me just mute this. Okay. So I have a couple here. One of them is a TFT display. It seems like this uses I2C. I don't know if it also supports. So there's an SD card module like within this. There's an SD card interface within this module. I think that uses SPI, but the display itself probably uses I2C based on the pins that are exposed here. I'm just taking a guess. Then I have, and this one is exciting for me because I ordered these MPU 6050s. These are basically modules that contain a gyroscope and an accelerometer. So you can basically use it as a tracking device to like track your position in 3D space, position and rotation in 3D space. Actually, I'm gonna have to. Yeah, I think you can track your position as well. Yeah. I believe you can track both your position and rotation in 3D space. Something that I want to do is, so I have two ideas. One is I want to create my own sort of hand tracked mouse device, pointing device. And another is, give me a second. Okay, so one is that I want to create a sort of hand-tracked pointing device, and another is I want to try and create my own trackers for VR chat. That's going to be an interesting one because I'm going to have to fake certain tracking points. So I'll have to see how to go about sending that information. But the good news is that I feel like Slime VR is gonna handle a bunch of the other stuff for me. What I want to do is I want to use Slime VR, but using my own hardware. And I'm mainly only concerned with hand tracking movement for now. Maybe if I'm able to get it to use the tracking information for head movement as well, then that would be great. So I can then get creative with it. I want to see where or how far I can go in terms of faking, not even faking, it's basically creating my own tracking solution. It's going to be a very janky solution, but it's going to be something that I've been hoping to do for years, like literally years. For years I've been hoping for there to be a solution where I can just create my own janky body tracking, just so I could track maybe only the hands or you know, only the head or whatever. So hopefully at some point I'll be able to do that as well. But yeah, all of this is going to lead into that. There's also some projects that I have in mind, which I can't really talk about right now, because they're sort of secret projects. They're a surprise for someone. And tomorrow I might do a Python stream, because one of those projects is going to require some Python code. Actually, a lot of Python code. I'm going to be using MicroPython, which fortunately ESP32 supports MicroPython, so I have like a whole bunch. Like there's extensive MicroPython support. So what I plan to do, the thing that I'm planning to make, it's going to require a fair bit of Python code. There's also going to be, because like I'm the one designing the hardware that's going to be running that code, or that's going to be using that code. Why was I talking about the hardware? Okay, so basically the idea is that I'm trying to make something. Okay, I'm going to be the one designing the hardware. I'm also going to be the one designing the software. And the software part of it is going to be a fair bit of code. So I want to try setting that up. I can do that coding on stream, or at least part of that coding on stream. Most of that code is going to be running on the ESP32. Actually, all of that code is going to be running on the ESP32. And there's also going to be some rendering code for that. The rendering code is going to be... the rendering code is going to be responsible for rendering stuff onto the TFT displays. I still haven't decided like all of the items that I'm going to be using, or I haven't decided on all of the features of this project that I'm building. But the software portion of it, I can definitely work on the software side of it. So I'm gonna work on just a bare Python implementation first, and then I'm gonna move that over to MicroPython. I'm not doing something special in, like, even when I'm doing it in bare Python, I'm not gonna be doing something special that cannot be done in MicroPython, so I don't need to worry about you know, too many feature differences between Python and MicroPython. What else? Yeah. So I'm gonna need to, because I need to design this in. I need to think about how I want to go about designing this, because what I have in mind is I'm gonna create the. Wait, what page am I on here? What did I open up? Oh, I was talking about the Arduino thing, dude. Give me a second to talk about why Arduino is great if you're a beginner. Like, I mean, it's great for people who are advanced as well, but like if you're an absolute beginner and you're looking to get into electronics, or more specifically digital electronics, playing around with microcontrollers and stuff, Arduino is great, because it does a fair bit of like it kind of guides you into it by holding your hand, because there's a whole bunch of examples, there's a whole lot of like documentation and stuff available, there's a lot of support for various things. They have their own boards as well, their own dev boards. So one example of a dev board is the Arduino Uno, and they have like a bunch more as well. So what I was planning to do, because these days I only use ESP32s, so what I was planning on doing is, because I want to get back into playing around with microcontrollers, what I'm going to do is I'm going to look at all of the examples here. Oh yeah, another reason I was saying that, you know, Arduino is great for beginners is because you have a bunch of these built-in examples. Like when you download the IDE, I believe these examples come along with that. So all you need to do is load up the example, and the code is right there for you. And you can then upload the code to whatever Arduino board is connected to your computer. It's great. It's great. There's also like comments, and let me give you an example here. So let's look at the first thing. Let's look at the first thing over here. This is, I believe this was with a potentiometer. Yeah. So this is showing how to read an analog signal. And it gives you like a bunch of explanation about what's going on. It shows you the circuit diagram, how you're meant to be connecting this stuff, how you're meant to set up the circuit. It also shows you a schematic, as you can see. And then there's a code. It explains all of the code. And this is just one example. This is the most basic of basic examples. It goes into much more fairly complex things as well. And through this, you'll gradually get introduced to various electronics related concepts. It's great. What I'm planning on doing is I'm going to go through all of these examples, but I'm going to apply them in MicroPython. These examples are being applied in C because, well, C, C++, I don't remember exactly which one it is, but it's a C, C++. It's an Arduino version of C, C++. Let's say that. So basically, you can use C, C++. I don't know if all of the features are there, but like it uses a C-like language. I guess that's a better way to put it. It uses a C-like language. So if you know C, C++, or even C Sharp for that matter, you should be able to pick up the language like fairly easily. Actually, I don't know if it's a C-like language or if it's actually C, C++, because I think, okay, the language is basically C, C++. Yeah, I believe it's basically C, C++. But I don't think like all of the C, C++ features are in this or are supported by Arduino. I think there is a limitation to the features. Though don't quote me on this, because like I haven't touched it in a while. Once I started using ESP32s and I learned that, oh, I can use MicroPython, I was like, okay, let's just push the C, C++ stuff to the side. I'm going to use MicroPython. At a later point, what I want to try and do is I want to try to use Rust for, you know, embedded programming, but that's going to be at a later time. For now, Python is actually, or MicroPython is getting the job done pretty well, and there's extensive support for MicroPython. Even like any modules that I can think of, or any modules that I'm ordering online to do various projects with, there's a decent chance that I'm gonna find code already written for that module, not just in C, C++, but also in MicroPython. So I mean, I'm gonna stick with MicroPython. Besides, I'm also pretty comfortable with Python, with the Python language. I think I've been doing Python for close to a decade now, so like I'm fairly comfortable with the language. Okay, going back to the project thing that I was talking about. So the idea is the code is going to be running on an ESP32, and the thing that I'm making, the device that I'm making, it requires some kind of display. So I'm going to be using two TFT displays for that. And fortunately, there's also code already written, MicroPython code already written for driving those TFT displays. So my only thing now is figuring out the logic that I need to create that uses these already built libraries. So it a fair bit of the work is already done for me. I need to mainly focus on the software part and also putting together the hardware. So what I'm thinking is I'll just so that I'm able to do the Python coding in regular Python before moving into MicroPython and before having to test it out on a microcontroller and stuff, just so I'm able to do it in that way, I'm thinking I'll write the code in such a way that the, let's call it game logic. The game logic is separate from the rendering logic. I'm gonna have to figure out a good way to do this, just so that it makes it easier for me to move, for me to write the code in regular Python and test out the code in regular Python, and then I can move that code over to MicroPython and just add in the rendering code on top of that. If I'm able to pull this off, then I should have something that's, you know, decoupled. I should have code where the game logic is decoupled from the rendering logic, and I just need to plug in the rendering logic, so to speak. I'm still trying to come up with ideas for the thing that I'm trying to build. More on that later. I have to sit down and write down all the ideas, essentially make a game design document for this. It's going to be a fairly simple thing, but even that fairly simple thing, the thing is, I only have like 2 weeks to do it. So I'm kind of on a time crunch. Yeah, let's see how that goes. I'm still not sure if I'll even be able to complete it in time, but I'm sure as hell gonna try and complete it. Even if I don't complete it in time, I'll finish the thing and I'll give it to whoever the surprise is for. Okay. So I was reading up on I2C. Once I'm done reading up on this, I want to test it out using my MPU 6050. I have two of them so far, and I've placed an order for a couple more as well. I think I ordered 3 more. I don't remember. Once I'm comfortable with using I2C to communicate with various modules, I feel like it's gonna really like step things up for me in terms of being able to do electronics stuff, because at that point I'm going to be able to communicate with various modules. Currently I'm not communicating with any modules outside of the ESP32. Two modules that I've communicated with were infrared modules. One was a receiver and one was a transmitter, but they didn't really use any protocol. They were, each of them just had 3 pins. One was VCC, one was ground, and the other was either a receiver or sender. So like, you could send data to it. In the case of the transmitter, you could send data, and based on how you are, how do I say this? It's infrared. You send the data in like pulses, right? And as you're sending the data, it's gonna be shown through the, or it's gonna be output through the infrared LED. You can't see it with like your regular eyes. The only way that you can see it is through something like a phone camera. So that's for sending the data. I was able to send, but I wasn't able to receive because I wasn't able to figure out a good way to get data from, basically I wasn't able to figure out the logic, not really the logic, but I wasn't able to figure out how to make the receiver work. So I still need some time. I still need some time for that. But yeah, the point is, neither of those were using any communication protocol. So I didn't need to worry about that. But all of the other modules that I have, they use a communication protocol. Okay, in 10 seconds, there's going to be an ad playing. So I'm going to hit the ad button now. I'll see you guys in 30 seconds. Alright, welcome back. So, what was I saying? Yeah, so far, of all the modules that I do have, I haven't used any of them other than the infrared modules. Mostly because most of these modules require some kind of serial communication, and I didn't know how to do any kind of serial communication until, like, yesterday. So yesterday I learned about the basic idea behind serial communication, but then also certain specific protocols like SPI and now I2C, and I think there's a couple others. Oh, I also learned about UART, but I don't think I'm going to be using UART, at least not directly. It was good to learn about though, because I had always been curious. I mean, UART came up when I was trying to figure out how the ESP32 communicates with the computer. Because you connect the ESP32 to your computer. If you're doing a wired connection, you're doing it through a USB, right? Through some kind of USB connection. But USB is a different protocol, and the ESP32 is using I wasn't sure what protocol it was using. Turns out it's UART. So basically there's a USB to UART bridge on the ESP32. And that's what handles the communication between the computer and the ESP32. That's what makes it possible to have serial communication between, actually to and fro, back and forth between the computer and the ESP32. So UART is another thing that I learned about. At some point, I want to experiment with most of the serial communication protocols that are available on the ESP32. I want to try and make two microcontrollers communicate with each other. Using those protocols. I feel like two microcontrollers communicating with each other is probably going to be a much better way to understand both of those, to understand the various protocols. I'm not going to be trying to implement the protocols myself. That's not the idea. The idea is to understand how the protocols work and how communication works between multiple devices. And the great thing with ESP32s is, this makes me super excited. I'm not even kidding when I say it, they are like dirt cheap. They are super cheap. In fact, if you order these things off of a website like AliExpress, you can, depending on when you are purchasing, sometimes you'll find some of the products on sale and you'll be able to get them super cheap. They also have these offers where you buy three of one item, or you buy three separate items, and you'll be able to save up on shipping costs. So it's great. It's also not all that expensive. Like every now and then I'll go on there and I'll buy a bunch of like electronics. In fact, recently I placed an order for a bunch of electronic components and modules and stuff. Some of them for this project that I'm planning on working on, and some of them for some of my own projects that I want to work on. Dude, you know, I want to try and do. I still have to see how I'm gonna set this thing up. I don't know how I'm gonna set it up. But I want to try and do like some electronics stuff on stream as well. The issue is I don't do any of the electronics stuff on my streaming computer. I have everything set up on another computer. So I'm gonna have to see how I can go about doing that. Or maybe I won't do it. Maybe I'll just stick to... Oh yeah, I'm planning on making TikToks out of it. I'm also going to make TikToks out of this this project that I'm working on. I'm going to be... I don't know, I guess you can call them like little progress vlogs. I'm going to be making progress vlogs to show the progress on the project itself. I only have like, I mentioned this before, I only have around 2.5 weeks. Now it's less than 2.5 weeks. But like around two weeks. I only have like 2 weeks to finish this, so I need to rush with learning how to do I2C and just communication in general, so that I can start using these different modules that I have. Because once I'm able to use the modules, then I have to figure out the actual logic for what it is that I'm trying to build. So like, I still have a couple of things to do. Another thing I need to do is I need to fire up my soldering iron, because I haven't used that thing in ages. I hope it's still fine, because I have to do a bunch of soldering. A lot of these modules, they came with the pin headers not soldered on. Like the pin headers came separately, which I mean, that's great, because it gives you the option to choose how you want to go about setting this thing up. So the pin headers tend to be optional, but in my case I need them to be there. I need them to be attached. And I also have these small PCBs, which I'm then gonna assemble my entire circuit with, because like the finished product that I'm planning, the finished product for what it is that I'm making, it's gonna need to be properly assembled. It can't be on a breadboard. But yeah, dude, let's carry on with this. I've been yapping for like close to 40 minutes now. Anyways, let's carry on with this. So I2C requires a mere 2 wires, like asynchronous serial, but those 2 wires can support up to 1008 peripheral devices. Also, unlike SPI, okay, by the way, I finished reading a bunch of this other stuff that was there, so like I'm not reading from the very beginning. Just wanted to mention that. Okay. Also, unlike SPI, I2C can support a multi-controller system, allowing more than one controller to communicate with all peripheral devices on the bus. Although the controller devices can't talk to each other over the bus and must take turns using the bus line. Hold on, back up. Yeah, so okay, the idea is that I2C can be used to allow more than one controller to talk to whatever peripheral we are talking about. Okay. However, the controller devices can't talk to each other over that bus and must take turns using the bus lines. Okay. All right. Data rates fall between asynchronous serial and SPI. Most I2C devices can communicate at 100 kilohertz or 400 kilohertz. There is some overhead with I2C. For every 8 bits of data, what is going on? Hold on, dude. Okay. There's some overhead with I2C. For every 8 bits of data to be sent, one extra bit of metadata, the ACK or NAC bit, or NAC, let's say, which we'll discuss later, must be transmitted. Okay. The hardware required to implement I2C is more complex than SPI, but less than asynchronous serial. It can be fairly trivially implemented in software. Okay. Oh, so this is interesting. Yesterday when I learned about SPI, I finally understood what exactly they were talking about when they said hardware SPI versus software SPI. So the idea with hardware-based SPI is that you use the specific pins that are that are designated for SPI-related communication. But then if you're using software-based SPI, you're able to use any of the pins for that. There are differences between using software versus hardware. I believe they said that software is a bit slower than hardware-based, because with hardware-based, there's dedicated hardware for that purpose. Whereas with software-based, a fair bit of the load comes on the microcontroller or on whatever processor is being used. So that was interesting to find out. And based on what they're saying here, I believe even I2C has like a software and a hardware based thing. Okay, you may be familiar with the terms master and slave to represent the relationship between devices on an I2C bus. The terms are considered obsolete and are now replaced with the terms controller and peripheral. Yeah, I read about this as well yesterday in SPI. I'm glad that they mentioned it here, because if I would have seen this elsewhere, I might have been confused, seeing controller and peripheral. Rather, I should say, if I had learned about only master and slave, and then I saw controller and peripheral somewhere else, I wouldn't have known about this, and I would be confused about what exactly I'm looking at. So it's great that they introduced it with this. Like, they mentioned that, oh, these are the obsolete terms that were used, and these are the replacement terms that are used now. And here they're mentioning that, yeah, the naming convention may vary and this and that. Okay, great. So master is the controller, which is usually going to be a microcontroller, and then slave is going to be the peripheral, which is going to be some kind of module that is trying to communicate with the controller. So a brief history of I2C. I2C was originally... Wow. I2C was originally... developed in 1982 by Philips. Okay, I thought they were going to say, like, they were saying somebody's name, but no, this is the company. So it was developed by Philips for various Philips chips. The original spec allowed for only 100 kilohertz communications and provided only for 7-bit addresses. Give me a second. I think the music must have stopped. Yes, the music stopped. By the way, shout out to The Birthday Massacre. Go check them out. Pretty awesome band, pretty awesome music. Where was I? Which page was it? Here, okay. Oh, another thing that I'm going to be looking into, that's going to be on my own time, is the concept of pull-up and pull-down resistors. because I've seen this concept mentioned a lot around, mostly around microcontrollers. And with the little bit of reading that I've done on it, it seems like it has more to do with digital circuits than with analog circuits. It might have some use in analog circuits, I don't know. But like, it seems like it's a lot more used in like digital and like logic based circuits. It's used to either hold a pin high or hold a pin low. So I'm going to be reading up on that more. I found this very useful. What I'm hoping is going to be a very useful explanation, because this person mentioned, let's go back to the basics, and then they started explaining this whole thing, and then there's this whole like essaying kind of thing here. So I'm excited to read this, and I'm also going to be reading a bunch of the other stuff as well. Well, a bunch of other Reddit threads on this topic as well. But yeah, getting back to this. Provided for only 7-bit addresses, limiting the number of devices on the bus to 112. There are several reserved addresses which will never be used for valid I2C addresses. In 1992, the first public specification was published, adding a 400 kHz fast mode as well as an expanded 10-bit address space. Much of the time, for instance, in the Atmega device on many Arduino compatible boards, device support for I2C ends at this point. There are three additional modes specified. Oh, chill out. My God, my mouse wheel is freaking out. Okay. Oh, give me a second. Okay. There are three additional modes specified. Fast mode plus, which is 1 MHz, high speed mode at 3.4 MHz, and ultra fast mode at 5 MHz. By the way, real quick, something else that I'm excited to play around with, especially with microcontrollers and with electronics, something else that I'm excited to play around with is radio frequency, RF based stuff, because that's always been an interesting topic to me, an interesting concept to me. But something that I'm trying to do is I'm trying to avoid going too deep into the RF calculations, because I wanna stick to using modules or using specific peripherals to accomplish the RF part of it. But I want to do RF stuff. I just don't want to go deep enough or too deep into it to where I'm having to do RF related calculations. One of the reasons being that I'm not designing RF hardware, I'm trying to use RF for various purposes. Because if I feel like if I start spending time trying to do RF calculations, trying to learn RF calculations, because dude, there's a lot to get into when we talk about RF based stuff. So I wanna save that time to do other stuff. The time that I would be spending learning about RF calculations and designing RF hardware, I wanna use that time for something else, which would then eventually be using RF technology. So my idea is to get a high level understanding of how radio frequency technology works, and then start using various modules to do RF based stuff. So I mean, not just modules, I mean the ESP32 also has RF capabilities, which is why it allows you to do Wi-Fi related stuff, for example. I don't know if it's also capable of doing Bluetooth stuff. I'm gonna have to look into the ones that I have. But it can definitely do Wi-Fi stuff. And aside from that, I've also ordered separate RF related modules. I can't remember the frequencies for both of them. One of them was I think I have it here. Yeah, I think give me a second. I don't know if you guys can hear it. You can probably hear this. Yeah, so I have them in the little plastic bags. Give me a second. Wow, this thing is slippery. It does not want to open. Okay, got it open. All right, so I can't remember. Oh, you know what? Why was I doing this? I could just look it up here and I could show it to you because I think SparkFun has it as well. It's a NRF24L01, I believe. They might have the thing listed here somewhere. Okay, NRF24L01. So it's this. It's a transceiver, but it's not just the IC. What I got is the board itself. Not this board specifically, but I got one. You know what, let me just search for this thing. Let's see what shows up. Right, so What I ordered is something similar to this. It's not exactly this, but it's something similar to this. The frequency it works at is this, 2.4 gigahertz. And then there's another module that I ordered a while back, which... Hold on, did I combine both? Oh yeah, I think I combined both of these. So there was something else that I had ordered a while back. I believe that was also a transceiver. But it wasn't the same frequency as this. It was a different frequency. I think that worked on a frequency that like consumer electronics use. You would find that kind of frequency with toys. Dude, let me tell you, like, learning about RF-based stuff is super interesting. Because, like, RF is, it's everywhere around you. There's so much stuff that is possible through like, radio frequency. If you want to learn about how interesting RF stuff can get, just look up the term ham radio, H-A-M radio. Just look that up, go down that rabbit hole and explore all you can, because there's a fair bit of RF based stuff. I mean, it's in the name, ham radio, right? It's there's a fair bit of like hobby electronics stuff going on there, and ham radio is used to this day for various purposes, like a lot of different purposes, because the whole idea with radio frequency is being able to transmit information through the airwaves, right? So if you are able to transmit signals or transmit information through the airwaves, you can use that for anything. You can transmit voice, you can transmit files, you can transmit video, audio, anything, right? And it gets really interesting when you dive deeper into RF. You know what? Maybe I can make a stream out of that. Maybe I can just explore RF, or well, try to continue just getting a high level overview of RF related stuff. I could do that. Because, like, I mean, I've already done it, and dude, it is super interesting to me. It is really interesting. Like, it's so I didn't know. Just to give you an idea of why I'm saying it's interesting, I did not know that there are certain frequencies that you are not allowed to operate on. There's certain set frequencies that are legally, you know, it, or how do I say this? There's a standard that is universally agreed upon for various ranges of radio frequencies that people are going to use for various purposes. So they have like different ranges that are allotted for different types of things. So consumer electronics have their own thing. Let's say radio stations have their own thing. Something even more serious, like maybe, let's say the army, the military or something, or let's say we are talking about something like, I don't know if NASA has their own thing, but like something like that, that would have like its own range. Hold on. I need to show you guys this. Since we started talking about it already, let me just look it up on another system and then I can open it up here. Radio frequency ranges. Radio frequency bands chart is that? Oh, also another thing that I learned is that when you are receiving radio frequency is perfectly fine, right? But if you are transmitting the radio frequency, if you're transmitting RF data, RF waves, depending on what range you are in, you might actually need permission to do it, or you might need some kind of license. Even when you talk about ham radio related stuff, they have ham radio operator licenses in different countries. So depending on which country you are in and what laws, like that's how sophisticated it is. They have laws surrounding these things. It's super interesting. But like, depending on which country you are in, you may require a license to operate a ham radio, or to transmit. Maybe not necessarily to receive. Maybe, like, I don't know what the laws are around receiving, but for transmitting stuff, you would require a license. So like, if you're trying to operate a ham radio thing, in your country, look up the laws regarding ham radio. Now, give me a second. I'm trying to find this thing. Radio spectrum, radio frequency bands. Give me a second. Because there was like a chart or something that I'd seen. I can't remember where it was exactly. There was this thing where a standard had been set for radio frequencies. I think they're called radio frequency bands, like the ranges. I think they're called bands. But yeah, there's a standard that had been set for it that is mostly, you know, universally agreed upon. amateur radio frequency allocations. It is done by National Communication. Okay. It oversees how much radio spectrum is set aside for amateur radio transmissions. Where was it? Just a second. Like, I need to... Radio frequency... Dude. Okay, I'm searching this here. Why is one of the searches radio frequency ruin my face? Okay, anyways. Radio frequency standard. Let's just look at that. Applications, frequency bands, measurements. Where was it? Would it be under frequency bands? I think it might be under frequency bands. Or, wait, the radio spectrum of frequencies is divided into so-and-so. Oh, you know what? This might be it. Okay. So here's what I'm going to do. Just so I can comfortably Google the thing. By the way, I need to look at... Oh, actually, hold up. So the thing that I was looking at earlier, I just realized I was also looking at a separate thing. On this chip, I need to figure out where the thing is. This is RF5V. Oh, so yeah, one of the modules that the module that I showed you earlier, that runs on or it's capable of, you know, sending and receiving at 2.4 gigahertz frequency. Then there's another one which is meant for the smaller, or there's another one that runs on a smaller frequency which is meant for more home appliance based things. This module allows you to run at 315, 390, 418 and 433 megahertz. So I want to play around with both of these. So this is kind of interesting. This one has... I don't think this is using... I don't think this is using any kind of communication... You know what? Hold on. You guys are not able to see this. I need to show you. But I'm not sure what to look at. Hold on. Maybe I can bring it up here in the search. So 433 megahertz RF transmitter receiver. Let's add SparkFun there. I don't know if SparkFun is selling a similar thing. Oh yeah, it's here. RF link transmitter. So I have something similar. And there might be a receiver in the suggestions as well. So I'll open that up. And then I was looking for radio frequency. So radio frequency is here. Let's open that up. Okay. All right. So we are here. I wanted to show you I believe it was this. Right, so this thing mentions the radio spectrum of frequencies is divided into bands with conventional names designated by the International Telecommunication Union. So maybe I should look into radio spectrum instead. Okay. This might be... The frequency boundaries of the radio spectrum are a matter of convention of... are a matter of convention in physics and are somewhat arbitrary. Since radio waves are the lowest frequency category of electromagnetic waves, there's no lower limit to the frequency of radio waves. I'm not gonna go too deep into this. The point I was trying to make was, yeah, there's like a standard set for, you know, various ranges that you that get used for various purposes. If you want to read up on that, then you can look up, you know, these things. Look up radio frequency and also look up radio spectrum. And this is the transmitter. And then there's also a receiver, which I think it's this one. The one that I have isn't exactly this. Actually, the one that I have, I think it's capable of 4 different frequencies, which is kind of interesting. Yeah, I think the one that I have is capable of 4 different frequencies. I got these as well. The interesting thing is, this doesn't seem to... Okay, so I don't know about this one specifically. The receiver that I have... This is a receiver. This is a receiver. Yeah, this is a receiver. This is a transmitter. This is a transmitter. The transmitter that I have, it only has 3 pins. And this one has 4 pins, which is... It's fine, but my point is... I don't think that this uses I2C or you know, any of the communication protocols. In fact, the transmitter doesn't seem to have any IC on it either. At least not one that I'm seeing. Cause the one that I have looks very similar to this. And it has 3 pins. One is ground, one is VCC, and one is data. So to power up the chip, you're going to need VCC and ground. VCC is basically positive and ground is negative. And then data is where you send whatever data you're trying to transmit. I don't know. I'm gonna have to see. This will be kind of interesting. Though the good news is, because this doesn't require any communication protocol or any serial communication, I should say, because it doesn't require any serial communication, I could probably get started with this like today, like now. I'm not gonna do that though, but like I could. Oh, dude, you know what? I just remembered about this project that I had planned to do a while back that I never really moved forward with it. I mean, I started it, but then I stopped it at some point. I just kind of got stuck because I wasn't all that well versed with microcontrollers. Basically, what I wanted to do is, you know those toy RC cars that you get, the super super cheap ones. What I wanted to do was basically hack one of them, or hack the remote control more specifically, so that I could then control the car through a microcontroller instead. So I could write some code, upload it to the microcontroller, and control the remote control, which would then control the car. Let's just say I never really got around to doing it. So at some point I wanna get back into doing that again. There's a couple of different types of projects that I wanna look into. A lot of them are like communication related, but there's also stuff like what I mentioned earlier, stuff like you know, building my own tracking system, building my own hand-tracked mouse, which is like different from the tracking system, but it uses the same hardware. There's a bunch of other stuff that I wanted to work on as well. And it's all slowly coming together, which I'm super happy about. But yeah, dude, this will be interesting. Finally getting back into... Dude, hold on. I think I have the controller somewhere here. I'm just gonna go over to my workbench and grab the controller. Let me see if I can find it first. Because I think the car was somewhere there as well. Give me a second. Okay, I found it. Not surprising at all that it was just left open. Like, I opened up the remote and I left it on my workbench. It was one of those things where I was like, you know what, I'll come back to this some other time. So that's why I'm not gonna put this thing back together. I do that with a lot of my projects. Okay, so you guys can't see it, so I'm just going to describe it. It's a remote control. It has two AA batteries, which I just realized I've had these batteries in here for a long time. I should get rid of these batteries before they start to rust or rot and then ruin the case. Okay, so the remote control itself... The remote control itself, it only had two buttons. Because the thing, it was a fairly simple, like, thing. I think, basically, it was, like, front and rotation. Or just front and back. I don't remember. And it's a really simple chip. I think the chip might have like an... I think the chip might have like an ASIC. I'm not sure. I can't see through it. Well, not see through it, but like... I can't see the thing. Because it's on the other side. So I'm gonna have to open up this screw. So that I can get the... So I can get the PCB out and then I can see it. But yeah, either way, what I intended to do was basically hack this thing. I don't remember what my reason was for why I couldn't get around to doing that. Oh, another thing that I couldn't, that I'm yet to understand actually, is how I would go about combining two different voltage sources, because that bit always confused me, so I'm still doing research on that. But that bit always confused me, how I would go about combining two different voltage sources and how I would stop one side from accidentally powering the other side, when there's like two different voltage sources, and those two different voltage sources are meant to power two different things, but we are combining them into one circuit. So like, how would I stop one side from powering the other? Because like, for example, the microcontroller, it runs at 5 volts. Well, the microcontroller itself runs at 3.3 volts, but through USB we get 5 volts, and then there's like a voltage regulator that steps it down to 3.3 volts. And this remote control, it's, from what I'm seeing, it's running on 3 volts. Actually, you know what? Something I could do. No, that might damage it. If it's rated at... So the idea that I had was to just power this thing through the microcontroller itself directly. But if the microcontroller is putting out 3.3, and this is rated at only 3, I don't know if a resistor is gonna stop the thing from getting damaged. You know what? I'm gonna have to look into this. But yeah, dude, at this point I can probably get back into this. So I'm excited for that. I'm super excited for that, actually. And dude, the whole concept of like radio frequency based stuff, it's always been like very interesting to me. Because like, dude, a lot of things work on radio frequency. A surprisingly high number of things work on radio frequency. Like a lot, dude. It is a crazy amount of things. Even your Wi-Fi is using radio frequency. Even Bluetooth is using radio frequency. It's crazy. It is insane. There's like a whole other world that you can go into once you start looking into stuff like ham radio. It's crazy, dude. Okay. Now, give me a second. You know, I do study streams a lot, but I haven't rated any people that do study streams. I feel like I should start doing that more. Maybe get to know the study stream community more. Like, because there is a community here on Twitch which I'm, of course, a part of as well, because I do study streams. But like, there is a community that does mainly study streams, and it can be like any topic for studying. It doesn't have to be like a specific topic, but like, there's a community of people that do study streams, and I don't think I've ever rated a person that does study streams. So I think I'll do that. I think I'll do that today. I'm gonna start the raid. Oh yeah, that's gonna be it for today's stream. I'm gonna carry on with this research. My God. This person's settings don't allow to raid. Great. Awesome. Let's go to the next person then. Right. So we're going to go to... Hopefully this person's settings allow it. Awesome. So this is a person named Lil Cozy. Or is it Lily Cozy? Lil Cozy. Alright, cool. Great. Awesome. So yeah, that's going to be it for today's stream. I'm going to carry on with all of this stuff that I'm doing because I'm super excited about RF all of a sudden now again. And I'm going to carry on reading up on I2C because I need to start working on those projects that I had in mind. But yeah, hopefully tomorrow we're going to start working on that Python thing that I was talking about. I'll probably give more details tomorrow. But yeah, dude, I hope you guys have a nice day, and I will see you all next time. Peace.